everybody. It's good to be here. So I thought this was a good place to begin. This is kind of where it all started. Here's a photograph of me. I think I'm probably around 4 years old, sitting in the garden with my mom and what appears to be a summer day. I came across this photograph just a few years ago, and it felt significant for a number of reasons. I often study old photographs. I just feel there's a lot to be gleaned about my origins. And I'm just intrigued by the faraway look, the introspective child. Her gaze seems somehow directed not outward, but within. And I think you could probably still find me with this look on my face at moments in a sort of dissociative way. And also significant because this is about the time that I discovered making art and got really into making drawings around this age. To quote part of my own artist statement, "From the time that my tiny hand could grip a cheap No. 2 pencil, I have been compelled to the blank page. Pieces of cardboard from a discarded package, the backside of the old green and white striped computer paper, all of it held so much allure. The blank page was full of possibility, a window through which the child could invent her world." It's felt important to go back for the child, to understand her to some degree, to understand that compulsion to fill the white rectangle, to construct imagined spaces in two dimensions. As a child, I was very much drawn to fantasy, to the idea of alternate worlds, through the looking glass, the lion, the witch, and the wardrobe. Fairy tales and all of their darkness fascinated me. This idea of a portal that led to some other dimension or world, that really captured my imagination. So it makes sense that I took to making drawings. The white rectangle, the blank page, that was my portal. So here's a drawing I made around the age of 10. As you can see, there's a family preparing to go ice skating. Then there's a central window, the view through which one can see a couple already seated out by the frozen pond. The man has one shoe off, preparing to put on his skates. And the clothes worn by all of these characters seems of another century. A bright sun is setting in the distance. So you can see that by this time, I've already developed my tendency toward the invented narrative. And perhaps I've always wanted to be the inventor of the narrative and the inventor of the story. For that reason, I felt less inclined toward observational drawing and painting. The only exception to this really has been my love of figure drawing and portraiture, and maybe that has something to do with the mysterious depths of the human face, the eyes themselves being portals. In fact, as a child, I predominantly drew people, often absent of environments. And I recollect my father remarking to me once how odd he thought it was that I always began these drawings with the eyes, the face, the head, the body would develop from there. Perhaps this was unusual, but I do see a relationship to my current way of working. I will often have an idea for a focal point, an area of detail from which the rest of the composition will unfold. Here are some recent portraits. These were all done from old photographs. This is my great-grandfather on my mother's side, John Bayles, from whom I take my middle name. It was interesting doing a series of portraits from old family photos, starting to see features that were passed down through the generations, like, oh, there's Uncle John's eyebrows, or that looks like Aunt Sue's mouth, or the shape of my sister's face. Of course, one starts to see something of their own face, and that is kind of amazing. This is Madeline Albee, my paternal grandmother. She was the daughter of Hungarian immigrants who lived in Trenton, New Jersey. I think in the photograph I used, she's probably about
18.
And then just one more portrait. This is John Barata, the late brother of an old friend. I did this portrait as a sort of memorial. It was a little bit of an eerie experience when I presented this to his brother. These portraits can kind of come alive in an intense way. And sometimes it even feels a little unnerving to have them hanging on the wall in my studio and feeling a kind of presence. I've revisited portraiture and figure drawing throughout the span of my adult life. It requires a kind of focus that's very different from the construction of my narrative compositions. And as the figure continues to reappear in my recent body of work, it still feels like a necessary component of my artistic development. Until I went to college in 1994 and entered a fine arts program at Kutztown University in Pennsylvania, I had virtually no formal art training. My art education was mostly classical academic, and I obsessed over figure drawing, the old anatomical drawings of Da Vinci, the work of Egon Schiele. I made piles of etchings because that was the cool thing to do, and I thrived in academia, always balancing the encouragement, time and space to make art amongst peers with the slow and subtle desecration of the purity of the child artist. I remember studying the old master drawings as an undergraduate student. This is a study of a horse by Da Vinci. Learning of their process of laying down a light wash of pigment on the paper. That would be the surface ground for the drawing, a middle value. Then the drawing could be developed with white or black or brown chalk. In many ways, this method expedites the process because that middle value is already there, and it doesn't necessarily have to be built up with the drawing process. From this point on, I began working with that technique, always preferring to work on paper rather than the more textured surface of canvas. A washy layer of watercolor or acrylic provides that initial ground from which the drawing will emerge. The next 8 or so slides are a selection of work that I have done, I think beginning around 2008, leading up to my most current paintings. I'll move through these somewhat rapidly. I won't necessarily discuss them individually. And while I do that, I'm just going to read a few excerpts from a statement that discusses some of the ideas and content behind these pieces. While the work has evolved, there is a particular quality that remains. I credit this not to me, but something that moves unseen through me. This is the work that I have been compelled to make on any given hour or day over a span of years. To look at this body of work retrospectively is to see more clearly the evolution of a unique visual vocabulary. Each piece is the result of an intuitive process, a playful tug between figure and ground. Layers of transparent pigments become the atmosphere through which forms float or sit, emerge or disintegrate. There is an explicit organicism that is both familiar and unfamiliar. Biology, landscape, things mechanical, parts of composite bodies. These constructed relationships reveal narratives that echo the drama of our human experience and the intricate movements of the natural world. Each painting is a glimpse into a contained world, a microcosmic surrogate for all of the mystery that is a body, a system, an environment. Through a meditative process of delving within, the paintings become landscapes of memory, dream, and invention. A manifestation of all that this body contains, primordial ocean worlds, my grandmother's face, utilitarian objects, symbols of our hands' work, chairs, tables, architecture, suggestions of all manner of biological movements, the ceaseless horizon, the depths of the human eye. I go back for the child with her tiny hands and fascination with fantasy, terror, things beautiful and otherworldly. Grief and longing can likely be found in each painting, as well as the inescapable tug of one's own mortality. How does it all relate? As an artist, this is what compels me the most. I want to present a space where we will be forever catching glimpses of new relationships. Where do all of these things exist within us? How might we choose to access them? Are there points of intersection within our individual bodies and between us, both as a species and as an interconnected part of the living pulse of the planet? It is here that an intimation of the meaning in this image-making ritual is revealed. All that came before, each isolated event that built us, continues to move within, rippling into the now and the yet to come. This piece, simply called Hands, from about 2012, this is perhaps the first painting in my recent body of work where the figure has returned in a literal representational sense. That is, there certainly have been figure references or abstracted figures in previous work. But I feel like this was one of my first attempts to integrate the portraits with the more abstract worlds of my paintings. And the small figure at the bottom, hard to see in the reproduction, is taken from an old photograph of myself as a child. So I guess this is a sort of self-portrait and kind of a portrait of the artist, because there's just all this weird stuff springing literally out of the head, these leaf-like flower forms and the hands that echo the gesture of the child below, and these strange organic clocks. This painting, A Page from June, is a portrait of my grandmother, my mother's mother, June Bayles. She died tragically when I was about 9, and so my memories of her are few. But I had this amazing photograph of her in her swimsuit having just emerged from the pool. A beautiful photograph of her around 16 years old. She's holding something in her hand, a book. I've always wondered what book. So I made this painting as a kind of memorial. The young teenager version of her in the upper right, and then a more mature womanly version in the foreground. A page is descending from one to the other. In some ways, I feel like she never got to be this wiser, more solid person. That person who is more assured, more in possession of herself. And in the title, A Page from June, I am thinking a lot about what she sent forward, what parts of her I contain. This piece is called Breath from Back There. It includes, drawn strictly from memory, the form that represents the simple little house that I grew up in Northeast Pennsylvania. This was a house built by my father. The little girl is me, again taken from an old photograph, little skinny me, standing and blowing up a red balloon at someone's birthday party. I dream of this old house all of the time still, while it has been well over 2 decades since it has existed in my life. It has seemed such a symbol of that childhood world. And the title, Breath from Back There, I was thinking about the child's breath stored in that little balloon. How the painting itself is a kind of balloon holding that memory, that dream. And here's another grandmother painting, Madeline, my paternal grandmother, you might recognize from one of the portraits I showed a few slides back. She also had kind of a tragic life, so I've situated her here in this world of whimsy and darkness. Two ghost-like figures in the lower right, seated with their backs turned, echoing the posture of my seated grandmother. In each is a kind of vessel that seems somehow related to the linking forms that surround them. A mysterious piece, I feel that it somehow represents a playful world of imagination that was never allowed to manifest in the life of my grandmother. The title for this piece is Sisters. It was originally based on a self-portrait. But then as I began working on all of these reclining figures moving horizontally through the composition, I realized that each one was kind of unique, and yet they were all clearly related. Again, hard to see in the reproduction, but each figure is being gently tugged by a thread of linked dots toward that dark form in the center right. Then there are these mask-like faces above. Perhaps they are guardians of some sort, and while their relationship to the figures below is mysterious, they do seem to have a powerful presence that oversees the action. This piece, Memory of Something Broken, is derived from what might be one of my earliest memories. In the grocery store with my mom around the age of 3, I knocked over a glass bottle of soda. I could still see the brown liquid spreading rapidly over the white floor. Then the upset adult faces above, closing in around me. This is perhaps my first memory of creating displeasure or frustration, a sort of falling from grace. The open mouths floating along the bottom of the composition are my own static adult mouth, frozen, that symbol of alarm, a lesson of that early memory. This piece, Guardians, is a recent painting that comes directly from a dream image. I look up into the treetops to see small children riding carousel horses way up high. I am worried. What if they fall? Then I become aware of the women below wading through the water with arms outstretched, waiting to catch the children if they should fall. Guardian figures. I feel a sense of relief and wonder. Each of Us, a Phenomenon, is another recent painting from a dream image. In this dream, I wander into an expansive open meadow. There I see many people standing, staggered, receding into the horizon, each holding a glowing smartphone to the sky. What does this mean? Perhaps a need each of us has to connect to something larger and mysterious outside of our individual experience. Then this pile of bone-like forms in the foreground, to me, is a reference to mortality, a suggestion of this non-linear kind of existence in which things are in perpetual state of living and dying. The swirling fields of color in the upper left remind me, perhaps, of cosmic dust clouds. I have also been thinking about these recent dream-based paintings a little bit like modern cave paintings. I recently watched the Werner Herzog documentary, Cave of Forgotten Dreams, and was kind of blown away. If you haven't seen it, it's a documentary that chronicles the discovery of an incredible cave in France filled with the most amazing artwork dating back 35,000 years. 35,000 years. It is reassuring to know that we've been at it that long. And the archaeologists were able to determine that the cave was not one used for dwelling, but rather was set aside as a sacred place for art and ritual. So somehow this felt like a validation of sorts, that the original function of art was spiritual, not about commodification. And there has always been this need for art as a way of recording and making sacred our unique human experience. And so these people holding their smartphones to the sky, this is a part of our modern spiritual experience. It came to me in a dream, just like the people of ancient times might have dreamt of hunting bison. I'll conclude with a few dream studies. These are simple watercolor pencil drawings that I do in addition to journaling as a way of recording the dream images. And of course there's invention here too, because there's always so much lost from the dream upon waking. And I think even in the telling of the dream, the chronicling of it, it is part invention. So already the thing is getting transformed by degrees. But I also think dreams can be such teachers. So this is an interesting process. Here's a small study for that carousel painting we just saw. And another small pencil study for the cell phone dream painting. This is from a reoccurring dream I have. Maybe some of you also have this dream, where my car is stuck on a very vertical incline. In this case, an incline of boulders, and I'm trying, almost always unsuccessfully, to back my car up this perfectly vertical incline. And yeah, I keep having variations of that dream. Who knows what that's about. And here's another reoccurring dream study. And this is a pile of shoes that I come across. I'm looking for my own shoes, digging through this giant pile of other people's shoes, and I keep pulling out this shoe or that shoe, and I can't seem to find the one that fits me, the one that's just right. And yeah, I just keep having sort of that same dream over and over again. Can't quite seem to find my own. I have a feeling it's a sort of identity searching dream. Okay, this is the last of my slides that I'm going to show here. This is another small watercolor pencil study. This one's taken not literally from a dream, but based more in a kind of playful, inventive space. And some people who I've shown this drawing have said it's very disturbing. And I've always been aware that there are disturbing components to my work, but generally, I try not to worry about that too much. And I guess I see this as a kind of symbolic self-portrait. The red life force energy always flowing both in and out, and the small dots that fill the being perhaps represent these seeds of fertile potential that this constant exchange of energy allows. Then the white puppet-like gloves, the maker puts those on during the channeling of the creative work. It is not her or I necessarily that is manifesting these images, but some larger force that moves through her. So in concluding here, I would just like to express some final thoughts about my work and my life as an artist. Of course, I've been working on this talk building up to the recent election, and post-election, I felt an immediate inclination to rework everything, to discover some new relevance in being an artist and the importance and dire necessity of authentic creative work in this dark historical moment. With this in mind, I want to say that I do believe that there are many forces built into the modern capitalist construction that are antithetical to these ancient human tendencies toward acts of the imagination. We need to preserve that part of our humanity at all costs. For it does seem to me that the means of coming together and comprehending our shared humanity, our connection to the earth and to each other, are hopeful actions toward healing our suffering world. One thing that has remained of primary importance to me is to allow for the discomfort of both solitude and of mystery. I don't always know what a thing is about while I am making it. Sometimes it's a kind of getting out of the way so that the thing can just evolve, if that makes sense. Then afterward, I can kind of step back and say, oh, so that's what that's about. And in order to allow for this process to unfold, I have found that I must simply be allowing a lot of freedom in my life. I'm certainly not one of those artists who can just clock in an 8-hour day and always know just what I'm going to be about in a specific time slot. It has always been of the greatest importance to me to set aside time to be present to many things beyond the physical act of making art. Reading, writing, wandering in nature, interacting with others, building all sorts of relationships, taking in the world in all of its darkness and immense beauty. These things are also imperative to my being able to find myself in the ancient mode of image construction, that intense focus of transforming a blank surface into a world. And I very much would like to encourage young artists to allow this for themselves as well. In this era when social media is so ubiquitous, it takes extraordinary discipline to find oneself in true solitude. I think a lot can stir in this solitude that offers so much fruit for one's creative endeavor, whatever that might be. As Rainer Maria Rilke says in his letters to a young poet, embrace your solitude and love it. Endure the pain it causes and try to sing out with it. And lastly, another quote from those letters that I've always held dear and as a fundamental wisdom around being an artist. Have patience with everything that remains unsolved in your heart. Try to love the questions themselves like locked rooms and like books written in a foreign language. Do not now look for the answers. They cannot now be given to you because you could not live them. It is a question of experiencing everything. At present, you need to live the question. Perhaps you will gradually, without even noticing it, find yourself experiencing the answer some distant day. So, thank you. And I'm very glad to take questions, revisit pieces, or, yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit about the process of these sketches? I'd love to see a lot of your, I'm sure you have piles of them. And
yes.
A lot of them are from dreams, and I'm sure some of them don't go anywhere.
Yeah.
But can you talk a little bit about the process of the transition from there to here?
That's a good question. Yeah, you're right. I do generate lots of these. They are definitely like a more immediate means for me to get images out, which I've always felt like I need that because the paintings tend to be a longer drawn out process. But it's not always the case that one of those translates into a large painting. I mean, sometimes the large paintings just come without one of those initial sketches. It has been more recently something that has started to happen of with the more literal dream images coming to me and finding it very useful. If I don't get them out visually in some form, they could just disappear quickly. So often what I will do is just have like a bunch of paper prepared with some kind of ground on it, and then I can just sit with those. If I have some kind of journal image, sometimes I'll bring that right away into the drawing. And other times I don't. I don't have that. I don't always remember my dreams. So sometimes I'm just in a mode of pure invention. Yeah. Yes.
So they're all nighttime dreams or daydreams?
That's a really good question too. The paintings that I spoke about that are literally from dream images are all nighttime dreams. Yeah, and then I guess you could say a lot of the invented spaces could be daydreams because, yeah. Yes?
I noticed you favor a palette of yellowish greens, oranges, and pencil. Does that have any particular meaning to you, or do you just enjoy
that? Yeah, that's a really great question. I work with color really intuitively. I often tell people I know nothing about color. I just do what seems to make sense. But I think the palette that I use currently, which I can't seem to get away from right now, is simply based on like a warm, cool transition in the piece. I'm really just drawn to these warm colors right now. They just feel to me like they have such a sort of life force kind of color about them. It's just like almost iron oxide-y or just very earthy. Definitely think I'm drawn to like an earthier palette. Oh, thank you.
It's not all watercolor.
No, right. Yeah, the small little studies that I showed are just watercolor and pencil and some gouache. The larger pieces, you recall I showed that Da Vinci slide because I was just getting at this technique I've developed of always having some kind of ground down on the paper. I don't start on a white surface. Just can't. What I do is I seal the paper with acrylic gesso, and then I will begin with a washy layer of acrylic. And that's kind of my starting ground. And during the stage of that washy layer drying, I'm already starting the compositional process because it starts to do some interesting textures and weird things as it's drying. And I often will have a rag and start creating sort of sections where there might be focal points in the painting. So that is a kind of important beginning stage for me. And then from there, I'm doing a lot of drawing with pencil, and then everything built up on top of that is an oil paint that I mix with a wax medium that makes it thicker, more transparent, and less shiny. And I don't always have the whole composition mapped out in my mind. Sometimes, like I was talking about starting with the eyes when I was a kid, it's literally like that. It's like this, I have this idea of this little form here, and I have no idea what world is gonna spring out of that. But then other times I do have, I mean, it really goes back and forth. Sometimes I do have a full composition in mind, but yeah.
When you say it's a wax medium, you mean encaustic or?
Not encaustic, yeah. It's this stuff called Dorland's wax. Yeah, it's stinky. It has some solvent in it, so I try not to use it too much without good ventilation, but yeah.
Ellie's very taken by the fine lines that you're drawing in the paintings, and I was wondering both about the imagery and metaphor that they represent to you, and also about the technique of building them up, or kind of the ink or paint as well.
Yeah. Almost always pencil, very sharp pencil. And that's, yeah, from the time I was a child, I just can't really be satisfied without some kind of linear component. And I think that, yeah, there's a lot of linking of forms in my paintings. And it is kind of a mysterious thing, but somehow, yeah, to me, it's a way of creating like a literal relationship between the forms that they are literally linked by these threads or these dots, just how, you know, in the world I feel that those threads that link us and everything are invisible, but I'm sort of wanting to make more of a sort of literal reference to that idea, I think is what I think is happening there. And it's just an excuse to use sharp pencils.
So it's
all pencil, yeah. I have this container of like incredibly sharp pencils at all times, and it's actually an occupational hazard because you can impale yourself, but yeah.
Just having been in school with you, and this is something I think these guys are thinking about as they move on from GCC and maybe to the next place, is that when you're working in the studio by yourself without all that community and the professors giving feedback, for better or worse. Do you have advice to people who are transitioning to that time?
Yeah.
More solitude and
right.
Trusting yourself in a different way.
Yeah, yeah.
Student to the artist.
Such a good question. It's hard. Yeah, I will not lie. I think having, you know, the witness while you're in school of your peers and your teachers, it can really like propel you and motivate you. And yeah, it is very difficult, I think, at times to conjure the energy to sort of get into that creative mode in total solitude. But I think, yeah, if you can have even just one or two people who, you know, visit you regularly, and even if you're unsure about your work and you have no idea and you might hate it, but I think just getting people in to be witnesses is pretty key, because I think it's otherwise like a very difficult thing to sustain without some kind of witness. And maybe just setting some like simple goals for myself. I've found that it's no longer like realistic to be like, I'm gonna be in the studio for 8 hours. But if I can say from 9 to 12, I'm not gonna leave this room unless I have to pee. So it's like, if I can do that, and then you'd be surprised at what can happen in 3 hours sometimes. And then And then you find out that you're actually in there for 4 or 5 because you got on a roll or something. So I think setting realistic, you know, doable goals, especially at first, is like really helpful for me, and getting out and seeing, you know, whatever might inspire you, whether it's like films or writing or other art, or, you know, I think, you know, continuing to feed oneself creatively is really helpful too. Yeah. We got one. Oh, go ahead. Yeah, I'll go for you.
Okay. When I was looking at these, they look like book illustrations, and you said narrative. Do you ever do them in a series, or is a story?
Yeah. Not really. Although, you know, with the dream images, I think that they're starting to unfold that way. I could imagine them perhaps like put together in a book form, and I've always kind of wanted to construct a book, so that's definitely something that might be in the works down the road for sure. And you have a question?
Sort of along the lines of what she was saying, developing it more, can you talk about how you're going to make a living in this?
Oh.
And how I mean, there's two parts to art. There's making a living, and then there's making the art.
Yeah.
Kind of different.
Yeah. I actually don't make a living with my art, and I'm not sure that I actually want to. And that's certainly no judgment on people who have decided to go that way, because that can be awesome. But I really just, like I was saying, freedom is like key for me to get into like this kind of mode of making images. And I just, for myself personally, really want no. And I'm not opposed to selling my work. I will, you know, occasionally sell paintings, don't get me wrong. But like, to have that be my main bread and butter is not, that has not been something I've sought, because I've wanted to preserve it as this kind of spiritual part of my life. And to me, I feel that that would be sort of adulterated by me literally not being able to eat if I didn't produce something. So that's just personally, like, that's been my trajectory with my work. And I do have a day job that I'm able to support myself with. And that's been, you know, a really wonderful job that allows me a lot of flexibility and freedom. And so it's worked out really well so far. But in terms of actually supporting oneself, yeah, I don't know that I can give a lot of advice, although I think what you're saying is there are two jobs, and I totally agree with that. It is a whole other, like, full-time job to you know, make one's work sellable and to get it into spaces where that can happen. And so, yeah, it definitely requires a lot of extra drive and energy. That some people are really good at that. Yeah.
Yes.
Very important. I think, you know, over the last like 10 years, I've managed to do maybe one big show a year. And by big show, it's like, you know, this or bigger, but it's like really helpful for me to have viewers and audience who are taking it in, and to feel that it's not just me or about me, and that it is about connecting to, you know, people in a larger audience and giving back. And I definitely see it not so much as a commodity, but as a service, because I think, yeah, this is a really important thing that humans have done for millennia, and we need it. And it's mysterious why we need it, but I feel like I know in my heart that, like, it's needed. And so, yes, I'll say very important to have an audience. Yeah.
It's a really interesting question. I think something that a lot of artists think about, what am I doing? You know, what am I doing and why? And you know, I have no answers. But certainly we have a need to make art
and you really need to see art, and so do other people have to need to see it and make it.
Yeah.
And then where commerce comes in, that becomes tricky, because we all know there are some artists making millions and millions of people doing art.
Yeah.
We all have to decide what is our goal. Is that our goal?
Exactly.
And then how does that change what we're doing?
Right.
You know, sometimes I think that since I don't depend on my art to make my money, I have a position here, that I'm more free to not worry about one that I'm in, but also free with what I'm doing.
Yeah.
That it can be dark, and that maybe nobody will want it, but that's okay.
Yeah, I totally, that really resonates with me too, because, you know, like I do think that, you know, some of my paintings can get into that sort of dark or disturbing place. And I would be really self-censoring, I think, if a number of people came in and said, they can't even look at that. And I'm like, oh, well, how am I going to sell this?
Right.
That would be difficult.
Or if the gallery handling your work and say, hey, you know what, this is selling better than that. Crank out more of this.
that would be challenging. Well, thank you all so much for...